After getting the AST required, means we have checked the value of the AST provided with the AST minimum and AST maximum. So after calculating the number of bars, the next step will be the check for deflection, nothing but serviceability criteria. We need to check whether the beam is the deflection will be lesser than the nominal value, limiting value. So for that, check for the deflection. So we are having this eighth step, check for deflection. In that, as per the clause number 23.2.1 of IS 456-2000, so it should be means L effective divided by D max, effective length divided by effective depth, maximum should be always greater than L effective divided by D provided. L effective divided by D provided. So we have already provided effective length divided by D ratio. So this ratio should be always lesser than the maximum value. How to calculate this one then? L effective by D max. So in that class only they mention. So we know that. Okay, I will open that one. Okay, to control the deflection as per the clause number 23.2, it is given here. And as per the clause number 23.2.1, the value, the vertical deflection limits, nothing but the maximum deflection, may generally be assumed to be satisfied, provided that the span to depth ratio, means effective span divided by depth ratio, are not greater than the value obtained as below. So this is the equation. So this value should not be, whatever the provided value should be lesser than the maximum value. So the maximum value will be given by this A, B, C, D, E. So here A is basic value. So for simply supported it is 20, and if it is lesser than 10 meter we can use this. Other than the 10 meter, if it is more than, the span is more than the 10 meter, may be multiplied by 10 by span in meters. So if I multiplied by 10 by span in meters, you will get the another modification factor if the span is more than 10 meter. Our span is 6 meter, which is lesser than 10 meter, nothing but we can use the value 20 meter. Simply supported it is 20, it is not meter, it is the value. Simply supported beam it is 20. And C, it is given that depending upon the area and the stress of steel for tension reinforcement, means modification factor for tension reinforcement, the value in A or B shall be modified by multiplying with the modification factor obtained as per figure number 4. Means we are having one modification factor for tension reinforcement which is given in figure 4. So figure 4 is here in the next page, in the 38th page. We are having the figure 4. This figure is for modification factor for tension reinforcement. And also we are having another thing, depending upon the area of compression reinforcement, D is given that depending on, this one is area of tension reinforcement, this one is area of compression reinforcement, nothing but doubly reinforced beam. Okay, compression reinforcement modification factor will be multiplied, means the modification factor is obtained from figure 5. So this is for doubly reinforced beam, so which is given in this chart 5, figure 5. In, by using this figure we can getting the modification factor. And A, B, C, D is over. Then E is here for flanged beam, modification for modification factor for flanged beam, means T or L beam. We need to refer figure 6. Okay, so which is in the next place. Here it is, figure 6. Reduction factor for ratios of span to effect depth for flanged beam. So this will be the figure we need to refer, figure 6. So in our problem we are having only the tension reinforcement because it's a singly reinforced beam. So means we can modify the equation of LE effective divided by D max as, I will write that equation, L effective divided by D as per the clause number 23.2.1, L effective by D max. Okay, so is equal to, we are getting the value by basic value, basic value which is given in A, that is for simply supported beam, the basic value is 20. Okay, this is the value, multiplied by K1. K1 nothing but it is the modification factor for tension reinforcement multiplied by K2. K2 is the modification factor for compression reinforcement and K3 is the modification factor for flange beam. So this will be the formula for L effective by D max. Okay. In our problem, so I already told this one is for tension reinforcement, nothing but singly reinforced beam. This one is for compression reinforcement, that is for doubly reinforced beam, and this one is for flanged beam, T or L type of beam. So in our case, it's not a doubly reinforced, means this is not applicable, and it is not a flanged beam, this is also not applicable. Only applicable thing is tension reinforcement. We have provided the tension reinforcement. We are having only one modification factor, that is K1. Okay, so how to get the K1 value? Then basic value is 20. So for simply supported beam, in the clause 23.2.1 is given that. So for simply supported beam, the value is 20. For cantilever, it is 7, right? So for simply supported, our beam is simply supported beam, that's why it is 20. But we need to calculate the K1, that is the modification factor. How to calculate the modification factor then? So we need to refer figure 4. If I refer the figure 4, in this modification factor, the figure modification factor for tension reinforcement, we are having along the x-axis it is percentage tension reinforcement, along the y-axis it is modification factor, so that is the K1 value we need to calculate. Then we are having some values over here, so here it is FS value will be 120 here, 145, 190, 240, 290, like that. We are having the values varying in the decrease order in the upward direction. Then we are having percentage of tension reinforcement. Along the x-axis, we need to calculate the percentage of tension reinforcement. With respect to that, FS value we need to calculate. Then if I move in the horizontal direction, you will get the modification factor. Then how to calculate the FS value? FS value is given by this formula here itself. They given below the graph, FS is equal to 0.58 FI into area of cross section of steel required divided by area of cross section of steel provided. So by using this formula, you will get FS. Means we are having two unknowns. One is percentage of tension reinforcement. Okay. So that is the provided percentage of tension reinforcement we need to take. And we are having FS value, that is 0.58 into FI divided by area of steel required divided by area of steel provided. By using this two value, we can calculate the modification factor. So now I will move on to the first calculation of the percentage. Percentage of the steel what we have provided. So so first, therefore, to calculate the K1, therefore to calculate K1 value, that is modification factor for tension reinforcement, I will calculate the percentage of tension reinforcement. So it is given by, so you can call it as PT of steel, percentage of steel is equal to AST provided, what we have provided, divided by B into capital D, that will be the overall cross sectional area. So it, the percentage is given by AST divided by the overall cross sectional area multiplied by 100. This will give the percentage. Okay, so means we have already provided 942.47 mm square will be the AST provided, divided by B value is 250 and overall depth is 500 mm multiplied by 100. So we are getting percentage of steel is 0.75%. Then we need to calculate the another unknown, it is FS. FS value in the IS 456, the given equation that 0.58 into Fi into area of steel required divided by area of steel provided. Okay, so if I substitute the values, your 0.58 as it is, Fy is 415 Newton per mm square. AST provided, AST required is 899.23 divided by AST provided is 942.77 mm square. Then if I substitute the value in the calculator, I got the FS value as 229.6. This will be the FS value. We got two unknowns. One is percentage of steel provided and another one is FS value I got. So now move on to the figure number 4. So figure number 4 in the IS 456. So here we got the two unknowns. One is FS, another one is percentage of tension reinforcement. So FS value is 229 and 0.75. So here 0.75, the value over here it is 0.4, and the value over here it is 0.6, and between that we are having one value, it is 0.6. okay, point, it starts from the minimum 0.1, point, sorry, it is 0.2, 0.4, 0.8, 1.2, like that. Okay, so this will be 0.4, and between that we don't have any value, nothing, but it is 0.6. here it is 0.8. our value is 0.75. 0.75 means we are getting within this middle. Okay, within this middle 0.6 and 0.8, it may be near to this 0.8. okay, so if I go in the stride, so we are having FS value we got the FS value as 229.6. here it is 190 and 240. Within this range only we are having the FS value, 229.6, 240, 190. 229, nothing but it is near to 230. So the value will be here. Okay, 0.75. If I go in the 0.75 percentage, in the X value, go straight. So the value between 190 and 240, which is near to 240. 230 is near to 240. So here it may be. Okay, then if I produce the line in the horizontal direction, I got one value which is varying with 0.8 and 1.2. 0.8, y value will be modification factor, 0.8 and 1.2, and this may be 1, is it right? 1 and 1.2. so our value will be here, nothing but it is near to 1.2. so I will take k1 as 1.18. I will take K1 as 1.18. That will be the K1 value I am going to assume. I am repeating, I got the percentage of tension reinforcement, it is 0.75. So 0.75 may be here near to this. This one is 0.6. 0.75 means it is near to this. Along this X value, I will move in the vertical direction. And FS value I got 229.6, nothing but 230. Which is near to 240. This value is 240 and 190, so it is near to this. Between this only we are having the 230, so I am thinking that it may be near to this. Okay, so if I go in the horizontal direction, so we will get the point after interpolation, or it may be by seeing the value, it may be 1 and 1.2, so which is near to 1.2, nothing but I will take K1 as 1.18. then I got the therefore I will write here from figure 4, okay, of IS 456 2000, page number 30H, I got the value of K1. K1 K1 I got it as 1.18. This will be the modification factor by using this percentage and FS value I got. Okay, then L effective by D max value I need to substitute. So we know that L effective divided by D max is equal to basic value for simply supported beam is 20 and multiplied by K1. K1 is modification factor for tension reinforcement I got as 1.18. And I don't have any K2, K3 because it's not a double reinforced beam, it's not a flanged beam. Now I will move on to the value. If I substitute in the calculator, so I will get it as 23.6 will be the L effective divided by D value. In terms of meter. Okay, both will be cancelled, right? It's not meter. 23.6 will be the value actually. So L effective length is also in meter, D is also in the meter. You start having the value. So just a value for modification after substituting in the with the modification factor, I got 23.6. Then we are having L effective divided by D provided. How much I provided? I provided L effective. Effective length is 6.23. And I provided D value as 0.47 because 6.23 in meter, not 470 mm we provided, nothing but in meters, nothing but it is 0.47. So I got another value which is 13.25. It is just a number. 13.25 will be the L effective provided, L effective divided by D provided, but L effective divided by D maximum is 23.6. Nothing but L effective by D max is greater than L effective divided by D provided. This shows that our beam is okay. This shows that effective length by depth maximum will be greater than effective length by effective depth provided. Means the deflection of the beam is within the limit. Okay, so we provided appropriate depth for the beam. Now after the serviceability requirement, we need to move on to the shear, means limit state of collapse shear. So next up will be design for shear. Okay, so it is ninth step design for shear or calculation of shear reinforcement, you can call. Okay, design for shear. In the shear, design for shear, as per the limit state of collapse, we need to calculate nominal shear stress. Okay, so nominal shear stress as per the clause number 40.1. So I will show you in the IS456. Here we are having the limit state of collapse for shear. So nominal shear stress is given by tau v is equal to vu by bd. This is the formula to calculate the nominal shear stress. Nothing but as per that clause, nominal shear stress is equal to tau v is equal to vu divided by b into d, effective depth. Okay, then vu nothing but the shear force, and b is the width of the beam, and d is the effective depth of the beam. So I will substitute the values. So vu we got it as 84.66 kilonewton in terms of newton, nothing but 10^3 divided by b is we provided 230 mm beam. Okay, multiplied by 250 mm we provided, multiplied by 470. Okay, 470 mm is the effective depth we have provided. So now after substitution, we got it as 0.72 newton per mm square. Okay, so we got that nominal shear stress as 0.72 newton per mm square. This will be the shear stress developed because of the shear force on the beam. Okay, this will be the resistance. Nominal shear stress is 0.72 newton per mm square. So after this calculation, we need to calculate tau c also. Tau c nothing but design shear strength. Okay, design shear stress is given by table number 19 in the IS 456. So we need to calculate the tau c. So that is design shear strength. Design shear strength. So means strength of the concrete. Tau c. Okay. So to calculate the tau c, I will move on to the IS 456. So in this table number 19. We are having design shear strength of concrete tau c value in terms of newton per mm square. So it is going to depend upon the percentage. Here we are having 100 into AST divided by BD. This is the percentage of the steel, and also we are having the concrete grade. Depending upon the grade of the concrete and also depending upon the percentage of the steel, we are getting the value. Okay, we are getting the value. So in our case we are using M25 grade concrete, and the percentage actually while calculating the AST provided, so we got the percentage here, right? So we provided 942.42, and the percentage value in terms of percentage we got it as, so here the percentage I calculated, this one is 0.75%. So percentage is 0.75, and we have taken the M25 grade. So 0.75 is here. Okay, so this is the percentage we have provided. With respect to that, we are having M25. So 0.57 for M25 grade concrete. 0.57 will be the tau c value for M25 grade, and with respect to the percentage 0.75%. So in our calculation for 942, we got the percentage of tension reinforcement is 0.75%. So for 0.75, if I move in the horizontal direction, so with respect to the vertical M25, the value is 0.57. So now I got the tau c value. So I will write here. So from, okay, I got this value as 0.57 newton per mm square. This is given from table number 19. Okay, so from table 19 of IS 456 2000. Okay, so we used the grade of the steel M25. Okay, and percentage is, a percentage of steel is 0.75%. 0.75% with respect to these two value, M25 and percentage 0.75, I got it as tau c. The resistance from the concrete itself, it's a 0.57 newton per mm square. Then I know the maximum shear strength, shear stress of the concrete, it is tau c max. So we need to calculate that one also. Maximum shear stress, nothing but tau c max, okay, which is given in the table number 20. So I will move on to the IS 456. So below the table number 19, we are having table number 20, that is tau c max. So maximum shear stress, tau c max. So with respect to the grade of the concrete, we directly get the tau c max. For M25, it is 3.1. So tau c max is 3.1 for M25 grade. So I will directly write here. So it is 3.1 newton per mm square. Okay, so this is from table number 20 of IS 456 2000, and with respect to M25 grade. Okay, IS 456 2000. From this code, I got the tau c max. Finally, we got tau v value, tau c value, and tau c max value. keep it in your mind. So value of tau v is 0.72, value of tau c is 0.57, and tau c max is 3.1. So this shows that tau c is lesser value because it's 0.57, and tau v is more than that. That's why this is the lesser value. Tau c is lesser than tau c, so tau v, and 0.72 is lesser than tau c max, means it is lesser than tau c max. It is lesser than tau c max. So this shows that concrete is not able to resist the shear whatever acting on it, that concrete only not possible to resist the shear. That's why we need to provide shear reinforcement. Hence shear reinforcement is required. So for this consideration, so you can write here, hence shear reinforcement is required. Shear reinforcement is required. Reinforcement is shear reinforcement is required. Okay, so if it is this value is lesser, so in the second case, the second possibility, I will explain that one also. In the second possibility, wait for a minute. Okay, here only I will take the sheet. Okay, in the second possibility, what is the case? If tau v is lesser than tau c, for this case shear reinforcement is not required. Shear reinforcement is not required. Okay, shear reinforcement is not required. Tau c itself is a bigger value, nothing but, so concrete itself resisting the shear acting on it, shear reinforcement is not required. So our case is second one. So tau v is greater than tau c, nothing but shear reinforcement is required. We need to provide some stirrups. Shear reinforcement is required. And another case, tau v is greater than tau c max, another value second. Okay, this is the third case. And this case, we need to redesign it. We need to redesign the structure and increase the cross-section dimension of the beam. So our case is this. But if the case is tau v is lesser than tau c, shear reinforcement is not required, but provide minimum shear reinforcement. But provide minimum shear reinforcement here. Okay, so we need to provide minimum value. We are having some clause to provide the minimum shear reinforcement. With respect to that only, we need to provide the minimum shear. But in this case, with respect to tau v value, we need to provide the shear reinforcement. Okay, so now I will move on to my problem. So we are having the second case. Second case is here, that is, hence tau c is lesser than tau v. Tau c is lesser than tau v means, so shear reinforcement is required. Second case, tau v is greater than tau c is nothing but tau c is lesser than tau v, shear reinforcement is required. Now I will move on to the design of a shear reinforcement to resist the shear. So here itself we have calculated the tau v value and tau c value, tau c max value we have calculated. Then here it is given, design of shear reinforcement. Design of shear reinforcement, in this tau v exceeds tau c, nothing but tau v is greater than tau c, given in table number 19. From that only we have taken, reinforcement shall be provided in any of the following forms. It may be in the vertical stirrups or bent up bars, or it may be the inclined bars. Okay, or you can see the first case, minimum shear reinforcement. When tau v is less than the tau c, this will be the first case. Tau v is lesser than tau c, given in table number 19. Minimum shear reinforcement shall be provided in according with 26.5.1.6. So in this code, they given the details of minimum share reinforcement. With respect to that, we need to provide the minimum share reinforcement. Otherwise, if it is required, then we need to provide in terms of vertical stirrups, and we need to give or bent up bars like that only we need to decide. So now I'm thinking that I need to provide the vertical stirrups. To provide the vertical stirrups, I will move on to the next page. So here it is given. Inclined stirrups also one of the reinforcement. Three types of stirrups we can provide. Either we can provide vertical stirrups or bent up bars or inclined stirrups. So I will provide only the vertical stirrups, means where bent up bars are provided in their contribution towards the shear resistance shall not be more than half that of the total shear reinforcement. So that is not necessary. Now observe here. Shear reinforcement shall be provided to carry shear equal to Vu minus tau c into B into T. The strength of shear reinforcement Vus shall be calculated as below. So means Vus equation is Vus is equal to Vu minus tau c into Bd. So first we need to calculate this value. For vertical stirrups, Vus is equal to 0.87 Fi Asv into D divided by Sv. This will be the formula, where Vus is this formula, Fi is the yield strength of the steel, Asv is the area of the vertical stirrups, then that D is the effective depth, Sv is the spacing. So we are providing vertical stirrups, we need to use this formula also. First is Vus is equal to Vu minus tau c into B into D. By that we can substitute here, we will get the spacing. I will explain it in detail now. So first we need to calculate the Vus. Okay, so Vus, so for the design of vertical stirrups, okay, design of shear reinforcement, so I will move on to that. Okay, so it is design of shear reinforcement. Okay, so we need to provide the required shear reinforcement. That's why I will move on to the calculation of that. Here we need to provide the vertical stirrups. To provide the vertical stirrups, we need to calculate the Vus. Vus as per the class number 40.4A, or you can call it as 44.4. So Vus is equal to Vu minus tau c into B into D. Okay, so we know the Vu value. Vu is 84.66 × 10⁻³. And minus tau c value we got previously. I calculated the tau c value. Tau c value is 0.57 I got. So I will substitute the value of tau c. So it is 0.57 multiplied by B is the effective, sorry, it is a width. It is 250. And D is effective depth. It is 470. Okay, after simplifying, I got Vus is equal to 176, actually it is 17685 newton in terms of newton. So means in terms of kilonewton, it is 17.685 kilonewton I got. This will be the Vus value. After getting this, okay, so we need to calculate for vertical stirrups. In this class itself, they given for vertical stirrups. Vertical stirrups. Okay, we are having a formula. Vus is equal to. So Vus is equal to, here it is. Vus is equal to 0.87 Fi Asv into D divided by Sv. That is the formula. So I will substitute here. Vus is equal to 0.87 Fi into Asv into effective depth divided by Sv is the formula. Okay, so in this equation, Vus I already know, Fi I know, D I know, I need to calculate ASV and SV. So in the design of shear reinforcement, first we need to assume the diameter of the bar. Okay, so ASV we can find. Then by this formula we will get the spacing of the shear reinforcement. So that is the procedure. That's why I will assume two-legged dia 8 mm bar for stirrups. Okay, so usually we will assume 8 mm dia or 10 mm. So 8 mm dia is enough. So I assume two-legged 8 mm dia bar for stirrups. So means ASV is equal to area of shear reinforcement is equal to pi d square by 4. D is 8 square by 4 into 2. Why 2 means it is 2 leg. We are having 2 legs, that's why into 2. So we will get the value as 100.53 mm square. Then I substitute all the values in the above equation. So if I substitute in this equation, VUS, I got the value in terms of Newton, it is 17685 is equal to 0.87. FY is 415. ASV we calculate as 100.53 multiplied by effective depth is 470 we given, divided by SV we need to calculate, that is what the spacing within the vertical stirrups. So after simplification I got SV is equal to 964.6 mm. This will be the spacing if I provide 8 bars of 2 legged bar, 8 mm dia 2 legged stirrups. So by this formula I got the spacing, but we are having a condition for the stirrups. We are having minimum spacing and maximum spacing. First we need to calculate the minimum spacing. So we are having the minimum spacing of the reinforcement by the using minimum percentage or minimum shear reinforcement. So we know that minimum spacing is given by the clause number 26.5.1.6. In this clause, okay, I will open that in the IS-456. Yeah, you just see in this clause 26.5.1.6 minimum shear reinforcement. I already told if tau V is lesser than tau C, okay, then use this formula, directly you will get the SV. So now tau V is greater than tau C, that's why I used the vertical stirrups equation, I got the SV, that is the difference. Now minimum shear reinforcement equation is this, so I will write down that one. So your minimum shear reinforcement as per that clause, ASV divided by B into SV is equal to 0.4 divided by 0.87 FI. This is the formula. It should be lesser than or equal to. Now I will take the equal, then 0.4 into 87 into FI. So from this equation, same you just provide the ASV is same. Here it is 100.53. Okay, divided by B is the value is 250, and SV we need to calculate is equal to 0.4 divided by 0.87 into FI is 415. From this equation I got SV value. If it is not, directly we will move on to this one. If it is shear reinforcement is required, so I need to use this formula and I got this value, and I need to check for minimum also. That's why I use this entire thing with the minimum value. So SV is equal to, from this equation I got the SV is equal to 362.9 mm. This will be the minimum shear reinforcement from the minimum shear reinforcement equation. Okay, this is from the vertical stirrups equation, this is from the minimum shear reinforcement equation, and also we are having another clause, so which is 26.5.15. This is maximum spacing of shear reinforcement. So I will move on to that. So from class, okay, maximum spacing of shear reinforcement. Okay, class number 26.5.1.5. Okay, from this class, maximum spacing of the shear reinforcement is given that the maximum spacing of shear reinforcement measured along the axis of the member are not to be 0.75d for vertical stirrups and d for the inclined stirrups with a 45 degree, and the effective depth of the member, here it is mentioned like this: under consideration, in no case shall the spacing exceed 300 mm. In no case shall the spacing exceed 300 mm. Nothing but it says that, so spacing, as per that class, spacing should not be more than, nothing but it should be lesser than 0.75d or 300 mm. Whichever the value will be lesser in all these four will be the SV. So 0.75d, nothing but 0.75 into the effective depth is 470. I got this value as 352.5 mm, and another is 300. By comparing all these four values, one is 946, it's a bigger value, 362, that is also bigger, 352 is also bigger compared to 300. Means in all these four value, 300 mm is the lesser value. That's why I will write a statement here: provide two-legged dia 8 mm stirrups. Okay, 8 mm at 300 mm center to center vertical stirrups. Okay, so comparing all the values, the four values what we got, so final value, the lesser value will be 300 mm. So that's why I provided the 300 mm only. Provide two legged dia 8 mm at 300 mm center to center vertical stirrups. Okay, so I given the things, the flexure, to control the flexure, I provided the diameter of the bar is as per the AST. I provided 3 bars of 20 mm dia, but now by using the vertical, whatever the shear, to resist the shear, we provided 2-legged 8 mm dia bar at 300 mm center to center. Now the last point is the development length. Okay, 10th one, check for development length. LD value, nothing but the bond between the steel and the concrete. We need to check that one also. For that condition, as per the clause number 26.2.3.3c, okay, it is given that, so I will open that one. Here it is, 26.2.3.3. So in this page number 42, it is given that at simple supports and at point of inflection, positive member moment tension, positive moment tension reinforcement shall be limited to a diameter such as LD computed for FD by 26.2.1 does not exceed this value M1 by V plus L0. This is the formula. Okay, so nothing but it should not be exceeding LD, nothing but, so LD is here. So LD formula is here, it is class 26.2.1. So in this class we are having LD value. LD is equal to diameter into sigma of steel, stress in steel divided by 4 into tau BD. This is the formula to calculate the development length. This value should be lesser, it should be less, it should not exceed this ratio M1 divided by V plus L0. So as per the class number 26.2.3.3c, we are having the equation that MU by VU plus L0 should be greater than LD development length. Okay, so in this condition we are having MU and VU, bending moment and shear force, and L0 nothing but the length of the bend or hook. Okay, so first I will calculate the left side part. So this value is given by, so we know that MU is, okay, this is LHS left hand side, this one is right hand side portion, you can take. Okay, so your left hand side portion, MU is, we know that it is 131.86 kilonewton, and VU is 84.66 kilonewton. Okay, so nothing but plus L0 is 0, I will take, means I am not providing any bend here, means I will take it as 0 because using no bend, because it's a TMT bar, we are not going to bend the bar, or no hook, we are not providing any hook, so that's why I am taking it as 0. If you are providing 4 times the diameter or 6 times the diameter or 8 times the diameter, then you can take the L0 as that value. Now I am not taking any hook, that's why it is 0. Now if I calculate the value, you will get this one as 1.55 meter. This one will be in the kilonewton meter, this one will be in the kilonewton, so value will be in meter, 1.55 meter. I got the left hand side portion. Okay, this is the left hand side portion, so 1.55 meter. Then what about LD? So how to calculate the right hand side portion, LD value? So LD, we know that from the clause number 26.2.1, LD is equal to sigma ST into diameter of the bar divided by 4 times tau BD. Okay, so this will be the formula, LD into sigma S divided by 4 times the BD, where phi, this will be diameter of the bar. Okay, phi is nothing but the diameter of the bar, and sigma S is the stress in the steel. Tau BD is the design bond stress given in 26.2.1.1. So the value of the tau BD is given in the next table. You just refer this to get the tau BD. Tau BD for M25 is 1.4, and also they given some statement here for deformed bars, nothing but for Fe415, so TMT bar, HYST bar, for deformed bars conforming of to IS 1786, these values shall be increased by 60%, means 1.4 should be increased by 60%, means tau BD value. So from the clause number 26.2.1.1, page number 43, the table. So I got tau BD is equal to, actually it is 1.4 for M25 grade, and I need to increase it by 60%. How to increase it by 60%? Means I need to multiply it by 1.6. 60% nothing but 0.6 plus 1, so means it is increased by 60%. Okay, so if I multiplied by 1.6 nothing but it, I increase it by 60%, so I got this value as 1.6, because for TMT bar increased by 60%, that's why. Then the tau BD value, I got it as 2.24 Newton per mm square. Then I substitute in this equation, so here LT is equal to sigma ST is 0.87 Fi, Fi is 415, multiplied by diameter of the bar, we are using 20 mm dia bar, divided by 4 into 2.24 Newton per mm square. So from this equation I got LD is equal to 805.9 mm. In terms of meter, nothing but it is 0.805 meter, is it right? So LD I got 0.805 meter. In the right hand side, the value will be 1.55 meter, means so this is more compared to the LD. Hence, so the condition is suitable now. So this mu by vu plus L naught is greater than LD only. Okay, so this shows that it is having the development length, required development length. Hence okay. If it is not, provide some hook, provide some bent up bar, means provide eight times the diameter of the bent or something else. Okay, then it will be match up with the LD value. Hence okay. If it is not possible, redesign. Okay, so this will be the design of the singly reinforced beam. Okay, simply supported singly reinforced beam. Now we need to give summary of the design, so we need to draw the cross section and longitudinal section of that, so I will move on to that. Okay, in the design summary we need to give the detailed information in the drawing. So first we need to draw the longitudinal section of the beam. So we are having the clear span is 6 meter. Okay, I will draw that one. We are having width of the support here, or bearing of the support. Okay. We have provided 3 bars of 20 mm dia. The bottom, this will be the longitudinal section. Okay, we provided 3 bars of 20 mm dia tension reinforcement or main bars in the bottom, and also it in singly reinforced beam for holding purpose we need to provide at least two bars of minimum diameter. Minimum is 8 mm dia as anchor bars or hanging bars, you can call it as anchor bars. Also you can call it as hanging bars. Okay, these bars are just to hold the stirrups as well as the main bars in position. So, and we have provided the stirrups. So we provided the stirrups. So these are the stirrups to resist the shear. These are all the stirrups. So we provided two-legged dia 8 mm at 300 mm center to center vertical stirrups. Okay, so the length of the clear span of the beam L is 6 meter, and the width of the support they given in the problem is 230 mm in both the sides. And we provided the overall cross section is 500 mm. spacing and cover we provided the cover 30 mm, right? So that will be the cover. Then I will show, this will be the longitudinal section. Okay, so in the cross section, the figure will be like this. So here we have provided 3 bars of 20 mm dia. Symmetrically we need to place those bars, and we have provided 8 mm dia as anchor bars, minimum bars. Okay, so these are the 2 bars of dia 8 mm, okay, anchor bars or hanging bars, and these are the bars of 3 bars of dia 20 mm main bars, and these are 2 legged dia 8 mm at 300 mm center to center vertical stirrups, and we know that width of the beam is 250 mm, and we know that overall depth is 500 mm. Okay, so this is the longitudinal section, and this will be the cross section of a beam. Okay, so this will be the detailed information of the beam. We provided 3 bars of 20 mm dia as a tension reinforcement. We have designed it. And these are the anchor bars. It's a singly reinforced beam. That's why it's we need to provide minimum bar, and this will be the stirrups. This completes the design of a singly reinforced, simply supported beam.